Microphone check. 1, 2, the microphone check. 1, 2, 1, 2, the microphone check. I got my headphones tuned between two different AM stations, and my briefcase is full of declassified information. Declassified, declassified.
Good evening, and welcome to News from Neptune for the 7th week of 2017. I'm Carl Estabrook. For 25 years, this program has been a weekly hour of spontaneous and unrehearsed discussion of the news of the week and its coverage by the media. First on a so-called community radio station, and now via Urbana Public Television and YouTube. Our program's name, News from Neptune, comes from Noam Chomsky, who's been writing sensible things about U.S. politics for more than half a century. In the American media, Chomsky says, either you repeat the same conventional doctrines everybody is saying, or else you say something true, and it will sound like it's from Neptune. Tonight, David Green and I will try to say some true things on a mutinous edition of News from Neptune. The mutiny I have in mind is the one that seems to be being carried out by the so-called intelligence community. Talk about an ironic name. The intelligence community, that is the American spy agencies, against the president. I would not have believed such a thing would be possible, but it's quite remarkably happening, and the media, our mainstream media, are taking it up with a vengeance. I was, quite literally, I think, I was astonished this morning to listen to a news report, so that's what they said it was, by a former sportscaster who spent the time saying that the Flynn case is a matter of small potatoes and that Donald Trump has to be indicted for treason, treason being his conversation with Russians, apparently. This is amazing. I mean, I'm old enough to have lived through the Joe McCarthy days, you know, and people knew that was crazy in various ways. But I swear the level of craziness is higher now. It's worse, David. It's astonishing.
Yes, it is. I listened, for want of anything to really make sense of anything, I stumbled over a podcast this morning. I haven't been listening to the Counterpunch podcast very much lately because I don't really like the host of that, a guy named Eric Dratzer. But I saw that the most recent one, he has a guy named Aaron Gupta, who I do like. Mm-hmm. Usually, although sometimes you never know with people. But
I was on a panel with Gupta a number of years ago, and you know, he and I ended up disagreeing, and this was in the old days, mean, 10, 15 years ago, so I can't imagine what it was we were disagreeing about.
What he was saying that made sense in response to what you just said is that during the Obama years, the only way that the right-wing media could deal with what was going on was to foster this conspiracy theory that Obama was a Muslim, a fake Muslim, or a Muslim, or the whole birther thing, or whatever conspiracy theory revolved around Obama. But now the left, and he specifically referred to about the top 5 or 10% of the people, of relatively privileged people, of what Thomas Frank calls the professional class, the meritocratic class. He says that what Arun Gupta says in this long interview is that the only way that they can explain what's going on is to foster this conspiracy theory about Russia and about Putin. So we see that even the well-educated people resort to conspiracy theory as much as the quote unquote less educated people.
But I can't imagine that that they're serious. I mean, it seems to me that when we hear people like Cory Booker, who desperately wants to be the Democratic nominee for president next time around, saying things like, Russia interfered with your ability to express yourself in the election and with expression of your opinion in the polls, that the Russians are secretly twisting the things that you hear, and you're being misled by that. Yeah. Now, that's really quite remarkable. It's very possible that you're being misled by the news, but it's a homegrown operation. Yeah. I mean, this is mainstream media in this country working for its masters, as it has all along. There is an interesting development, I think, in that the bitterness against the Trump administration is coming from what Max Weber would have called the political class. And the political class here, he did not mean a class in the traditional socialist sense of people who are defined by basically how they got their daily bread. What he meant was that there was a group in a modern state making up perhaps as much as 10-15% of the population that makes its career in government. I don't mean low-level government employees who simply go to the office for the same way people if we're working for a commercial corporation would go to the office. I'm talking about the people who are the career professionals, the experts and so forth, who staff a modern government. That is something that clearly has developed over the last generation or so in this country in particularly expansive ways. The political scientist Samuel Huntington regretted the days, and he said, in which President Truman could run the government with the aid of a handful of New York lawyers. Now, that's no longer possible. You have a much larger bureaucracy doesn't quite capture it, because bureaucracy includes those everyday government workers. And there's, therefore, to speak of a political class who do government, and do government as the recent Princeton study points out, on behalf of the 1%. The 1% themselves are not so much staffing this government as paying for it, or rather profiting from it, but the actual class that is the group that is carrying on government in this fashion is what Weber is talking about. It's the political class. They're the ones who seem most hysterically in opposition to the Trump administration, and that's centered in the so-called intelligence community, in the CIA, the NSA, and that what those 16 intelligence agencies that were told came to a conclusion about something some time ago. This is astonishing. Yeah. I for all my years of listening to the nonsense that came forth from Washington, this is new.
Well, a couple of things, just a kind of a footnote. One of the translators, or at least editors of Max Weber, was the famous radical sociologist C. Wright Mills, and his word for what you're talking about, of course, is the power elite. And I don't know if that you may quibble, or one may quibble about that, but I think the term kind of captures it. He wrote it in a different time and place in the 1950s. But still, these are people who have come to be called the liberal class. Again, interpreted in various negative ways by Chris Hedges on the one hand, and Thomas Frank on the other hand. And these were people who threw their lot in with Hillary Clinton, who came to believe that Hillary Clinton embodied the kind of meritocratic values, embodied the idea that they deserve to be where they're at, that they're doing well. What Aaron Gupta refers to as the top 10% who make over $100,000 a year, the top 5% who make over, family income over about $150,000 a year, and you go up from there. But these are the people who, as the recent Piketty data shows, this 10% of the people has gotten a 10% bigger slice of the pie in the last 35 years, which amounts to, in current dollar terms, to probably about at least 1.5 or maybe more trillion dollars to divide amongst them in their basic income. So these are people who have to justify that they've played the game. They've, as the saying goes, as Ron used to always say when he was on our program, They've played by the rules. They've done what they were supposed to do, and they don't want their worldview shattered by any ideas about that the system hasn't been fair to all the other people that they've beaten out. These people are doing well. Their children, as Aaron Gupta pointed out, their children are doing well. Everybody's proud of their children going to the best schools and be able to get at least some kind of job after they graduate from college, hopefully in not too much debt. This is the class of people that isn't affected by student debt at quite the same level, and that isn't affected by the lack of jobs at quite the same level. So the question is, what little I bring here today will reinforce your point, but of course it's the media perspective, it's the New York Times point of view, where all of the columnists are ganging up on Trump and talking as if it's already established that he will not serve out these 4 years. And what,
yes.
David, let me, I just wrote one thing that I wanted to be able to quote accurately today by David Brooks, he's a Republican, but of course he doesn't like Trump. The title of his column this morning is "What a Failed Trump Administration Looks Like." What a failed Trump administration looks like, and the one quote that jumped out at me because it's just so awesome that he says towards the end of the article. There are no longer arbiters, and he makes the argument in this that things aren't working the way they did with Nixon and Watergate and all this, and here's why. There are no longer arbiters in Congress like Howard Baker and Sam Ervin to lead a resignation or impeachment process. There is no longer and here's the cue, there is no longer a single media establishment that shapes how the country sees the president. This is no longer a country in which everybody experiences the same reality. Let me repeat that last sentence because it's so awesome. This is no longer a country in which everybody experiences the same reality. What planet is this man living on that he thought that with this was ever a country, that no. Any country should be a country where everybody, that any two people could experience the same reality. I know what he's saying. He's saying this is no longer a country where everybody watches Walter Cronkite, right. Huntley Brinkley, and whoever was on the third network at that time. Howard K. Smith.
Good for you.
So there you go. That's the problem. We're no longer experiencing the same reality. Everything falls apart. There's all these people all over the place just saying all kinds of things, some true, some not true, but we can't all get on the same page that David Brooks and Thomas Friedman and Paul Krugman,
right.
and Charles Blow and Maureen Dowd and whomever think we should
right.
be on.
Let's be clear here, though, that the same reality that David Brooks wants us to experience and the other media figures whom you mentioned, that same reality is the account of American society and politics that we take to be the unquestionable narrative of what the U.S. society is like, what the U.S. government is doing at home and abroad. That agreement, so to speak, was the sort of thing that could lead people to say in the second part of the Nixon administration that Nixon had departed from the standards of the agreed reality and therefore he had to go. There was never any question that there was a real debate about American politics with Nixon and his piggany on one side and others on the other. The question was simply how much of a criminal was Nixon under the standard narrative of American society. What's happened now is that David Brooks and his friends know that they have lost control of that narrative, that there really is a difference out there, a difference particularly along class lines in American society that may have existed but was successfully suppressed in the discussion up until very recently. That's important. Some people say that that difference, the reason that everyone listened to Walter Cronkite and therefore it made a difference when he changed his mind, some people say that the difference was introduced by the internet. When you no longer have a common source of news and political commentary, when you have odd guys sitting in a studio in the Midwest talking of something outside of the reality that David Brooks regales to you, when you turn on your computer and you find a website where they're saying, in fact, they're lying to you, and here's why, things have got out of hand. And I think that's exactly what our political class thinks has happened, and they are becoming increasingly hysterical in explaining how things have gotten out of hand and what must be done to bring them back into hand. The present notion is that an enemy hath done this, as the scriptures say, that Vladimir Putin, scheming away in the Kremlin, has destroyed Americans' belief in the narrative, and therefore we've got to get that back, and by the way, threaten Putin with war because of his destruction of the narrative. This is a very interesting time and a very interesting phenomenon, but I really think that there is, and I'm not at all sure that the explanation that it's the internet and the variety of inputs that are available to the people are really the source of this. I'm not sure it's all Alex Jones' fault, in other words.
I think it's all Noam Chomsky's fault.
But I'd like to believe that, yeah. but people are not so much listening to Chomsky as listening to Alex Jones. That's the point.
Yeah, so, I mean, I would like to have a consistent narrative as much as anyone else. I would like to surround myself.
An accurate one.
An accurate one that I could rely on, and that was at least reinforced by a few other people. But when the narrative on the left is so divided.
The left itself is so divided.
It's divided, and you look on the Counterpunch website, and I could find very few articles that reflect, I think, something substantial about the reality that we're living through right now. Part of that is because so much of what is going on hasn't been revealed. But also, the only at least semi-satisfying article that I could find to read on Counterpunch this morning in relation to these general issues but was by somebody who I'm usually not that impressed with, Mike Whitney.
Whitney, mm-hmm. Yeah. I had the same experience.
He put the whole Putin thing in the context of the China thing, in the context of the U.S. control over the, as you're always saying, the Eurasian continents, and the fact that Trump is, I'm not sure if he's right about what his prediction of what is going to happen, but he's basically saying that Trump is being drawn back from dealing in this reasonable way with Russia and with Putin, and he's drawn into this alliance, this in a sense alliance with China, against Russia, as a part of what Noam Chomsky has always called the grand area strategy since World War II. This is how we control the world. This is how we control the whole world in an economic and monetary way.
You're watching News from Neptune. We've mentioned a couple of times already this evening the newsletter or the website and a publication called Counterpunch. Counterpunch is edited by our friend Jeffrey Sinclair. It was founded by Alexander Coburn and Ken Silverstein a good while ago. It is, I think David and I agree, probably the most distinguished collection of commentaries, political commentaries, that one can find on the web. But that doesn't solve the problem, as David was suggesting. Yeah. It suggests the problem. I had exactly the same experience as David reading the Counterpunch list. Jeffrey is a man of immense industry and puts up a good number of columns each day.
And 30 or 40 on the weekend edition on Friday.
I was on vacation with Jeffrey a number of years ago on the coast of Oregon, and in an even more primitive media environment or internet environment, and I was amazed the amount of time he spent each day, even while we were beachcombing on putting this together. It takes a lot of work. But there is a second characteristic of it that leads me to recommend it to you and recommend a Counterpunch website, and that is Jeffrey is overwhelmingly Catholic in his taste. Not Roman Catholic, but lowercase c Catholic in the sense of universal. He outrages friends and allies on the left by publishing things that they disagree with. He publishes a very broad spectrum of what might generally be called left opinion, if left meant anything at all now in American political discussion. He publishes things he disagrees with, including things by David and me on occasion. So it's a wonderful website, a wonderful resource, I think, for talking about the politics right away. Let me ask you about one. Oh, go ahead.
I didn't know if you were going to segue. I was going to say, speaking of the you know, Israel lobby.
Exactly where I was going.
And the other modestly truthful article. I don't think it's that difficult, but there's one Israeli writer, Nev Gordon, who is making good sense, who has made good sense for years. He doesn't write a lot, I don't think, or if he does, he does it in a more scholarly context, which I haven't really followed. But when he decides to write to do punditry, one example is on the website this morning, and he basically says a very straightforward account. He's not the only one saying this. Is what Trump did when he met with Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu the other day, was to, in a positive way, abandon the pretense that the two-state solution is a viable option. Not that it isn't a viable option if the United States wanted it, but to abandon the pretense that's what the U.S. policy really wants. That's what the peace process has really been about. So, there, you know, just with one fell swoop, ironically or not ironically, whatever is going on in Trump's strange little mind, he is doing something honest that previous presidents couldn't and wouldn't do.
I agree with you entirely. That was exactly my response to Nev Gordon's article, and I recommend it to you on the Counterpunch website. The point is that he refocuses the discussion of what Trump said, Gordon does, in the direction of the fact that what one is dealing with in contemporary Israel is apartheid. An apartheid system in the occupied territories that Noam Chomsky describes as far worse than South African apartheid of a generation ago. Chomsky suggests that the apartheid, that's the apartheid light, so to speak, that suggests within the borders of Israel, not in the occupied territories, is bad enough, but it doesn't approach the South African, the viciousness of the South African situation. But in the occupied territories, it does, and that's what needs to be dealt with. Gordon takes the comments, quite remarkable in many ways, of the president with Netanyahu the other day as to suggest that this is the problem that has to be dealt with. The citizenship and the rights of the people who live between the river and the sea, who live in the area actually controlled by Israel, is what's at stake. And I think he's right. I think that's true. And I think that it's very interesting that he suggests that in a perhaps roundabout way, this is being suggested by the American president while his UN ambassador is screaming about the two-state solution in the traditional fashion, and other people in the administration are saying things that are far more retrograde.
Yeah, and this isn't to necessarily, again, to claim that I support one state or that I think that's feasible. I've continued to at least put forward the ideas of both Noam Chomsky and Norman Finkelstein that the alternative to two states isn't necessarily one democratic state. It will be one apartheid state, and that's basically what we have now. We have relatively, when you look at the whole area of Israel and Palestine, including the West Bank and Gaza, what you find is a relatively equal number of Jews and non-Jews, about 6 million each. And within that framework, you have, and that includes, of course, Palestinian citizens within Israel, within the Green Line from 1948. But what you basically have is those 6 million Jews as a privileged population with rights. You have those million Palestinian, 1.5 million Palestinians who are citizens, but are second-class citizens within Israel, and that's has to be acknowledged by anyone who looks at that. And then you have the other 4.5 or 5 million Palestinians in occupied Palestine, including the West Bank, Gaza, and East Jerusalem. So that is a situation that can go on and on for quite a long time. And unlike the people on Mondo Weiss, who are probably sort of celebrating the idea that Trump has acknowledged that there is one state, that they think that this will be, you know, their rather optimistic, I guess, view is that once we acknowledge it's one state, then people can fight for their rights within this one state. But they won't be able to fight as long as the United States supports Israeli apartheid. They won't be able to fight. They may be able to fight and they may be able to put up a fuss, but as long as they are being controlled by their own Palestinian Authority, by Abbas and the whole gang, then that's going to be a long, hard road. So the United States, again, to reiterate what Norman Finkelstein asserts about these things, international law dictates two states, and that's what the world supports. That's the practical thing that the Palestinians and their supporters should be fighting for.
And it seemed to me there are two points to be made about this, about the long-term position of the United States. First of all, the U.S. doesn't care about apartheid in Israel. The U.S. is not there either to support this apartheid and the privileged position of Jews in Israel or to attack it. The U.S. doesn't mind, it doesn't matter to U.S. policymakers the same way apartheid in South Africa didn't matter to American planners. The point is that the internal situation in both countries was, as far as American planners concern, a matter of local interest. What the U.S. was interested in was the support of these states in its worldwide geopolitical establishment. Israel is America's stationary aircraft carrier in the Middle East, and the Israeli-American alliance, the effective alliance, there's no formal alliance, dates from the destruction of secular Arab nationalism by Israel in 1967. That's what the U.S. is concerned about. Whatever internal relationship the ruling groups in Israel want to make, that's their business, the same way it was in South Africa. But the kicker in the matter is that it's only U.S. support for those ruling groups that allows the apartheid systems to continue. So in a roundabout or secondary way, the U.S. becomes the guarantor of apartheid in Israel as it was in South Africa. This could change, and that's the sort of thing that we're talking about.
And on a more personal note, and perhaps sort of more autobiographical note, let me just say that I came to my radicalism about 20 years ago through my understanding of the Israel-Palestine, through my early efforts to begin to understand the history of the Israel-Palestine conflict, when I realized that the narrative that I had been told, the liberal narrative that I had been, that I'd basically believed up until about the mid-90s was not true, that there was plenty of research that had been done in the previous 10 or 15 years by many, many people, including Jews, to redo that story, and that from there, far from just being a single issue, what that opened me up to was an understanding of what Noam Chomsky was saying, not only about Israel and Palestine, but what he was saying about U.S. power in the whole world. And therefore, when people say that, well, why are you singling out Israel and Palestine? It's like you got to start somewhere to understand the way the world works. You don't start with the world. You start with something going on in the world, and then you try to relate that to other things going on in the world. And of course, what you end up relating a lot to in this context is U.S. foreign policy. So there isn't. Where am I going with this? I want to get a shot in. Uh-huh. I want to get a good firm shot in at all those people who are feeling like now anti-Semitism is back on the right wing side where it always should have been. You know, it's not, they don't have, you know, good liberals were never comfortable with calling left, maybe never comfortable with calling leftists anti-Semites, because they questioned Israel. But I guess what
they still managed, usually.
Yeah, they still managed. But I guess here's the one thing I'll get to the point here. When I first started studying these things, and I said, well, who are these liberals that supposedly I've thought have had sensible views about you know Israel, all this, and I couldn't really find any. I couldn't find any difference between the neoconservatives of the 1990s and the liberals like Michael Walzer and Martin Peretz and all these kind of people who were still generally identified with a liberal way of looking at people. So therefore, those fault lines between conservatism and liberalism and ultimately neoconservatives and neoliberalism began to kind of collapse for me, which is why my own narrative, I don't have much trouble anymore in lumping all these people together, fairly or unfairly, as people who, again, just want to believe that somehow the world would be a wonderful place if only Hillary Clinton were president right now.
Well, it's important to see that that's in continuity with American politics, at least for 40 years, and in some ways back to the anti-Vietnam War movement, and that the Trump administration does introduce the promise of a change of that neoliberal, neoconservative continuity that Mrs. Clinton represented. And that's the battle that's being fought out right now with the CIA as the strike force for the political establishment. And I think that the people who suggest that it could get quite nasty are right. There is some discussion of a conscious purge of the CIA by the Trump administration. They're surely thinking about it. Whether they'll be able to bring it off or not, I don't know. But if they don't, it's pretty clear that the intelligence community will be able to wrench the Trump administration back in the direction of those neoconservative and neoliberal policies that have existed all in all previous administrations in living memory. So there's a real battle going on. There's a mutiny going on, a mutiny against the administration, and the outcome is not at all clear. The excoriation of Trump is part of it, but unfortunately it's not being discussed in terms of the issues, but in terms of Trump's personality, which the Clinton campaign discovered early on was the only way they could talk about the matter, because the politics worked in the other direction. They had to come up with these fantastic notions, fantastic in the literal sense of the word, of Trump as a Manchurian candidate doing the will of an evil genius in the Kremlin. I mean, you can't make this stuff up. They did make this stuff up, and it astonishes those of us who heard about it the first time around.
So I guess the question, you know, becomes partly, who can Trump I mean, he can't seem to appoint anyone to, I mean, among the people, among the wealthy people and relatively powerful people and right-wing people who he appoints to various offices, he can't really rely on any of them to deal with this in any coherent way. I mean, he can pursue various right-wing policies, and I think, as Aaron Gupta pointed out, those policies are in a sense anti-neoliberal in that they cater to domestic interests, like, you know, resources and finance to a certain way, and not so much to the whole trade thing, but still, how can Trump possibly, if it is possible, find any ground to actually stand on to challenge especially neoliberal policies? I don't see it.
It's a good question, and it seems to me that the answer begins with the realization that what got Trump the presidency was a split in the neoliberal ranks. The neoconservatives, the war party, those who promise more war against Russia and China or Iran or whoever you've got, the war party fled to Mrs. Clinton early on because they recognized that, accurately, that she was a serious warmonger and Trump wasn't. But the neoliberals were in a slightly different position. The distinction you made between trade-oriented neoliberals and domestic industry-oriented neoliberals, if you want, we need better terminology here, is important. Because it was the latter who supported Trump, whereas the former made the trek, if they hadn't already done it, to the Democrats early on. So when Trump cancels the Trans-Pacific Partnership and attacks the trade pacts, which are the daily bread of the neoliberal centers of American politics, he is doing the work of a faction of the neoliberals, and it's that faction that supports him. Men like Rex Tillerson, the new Secretary of State. Now, Tillerson, I think, is an interesting figure here and someone we should, as it were, keep an eye on. He's clever enough to have lied his way through his confirmation hearings, I think. He told the senators what they wanted to hear. But he also is right now discussing matters with the Russian Foreign Minister Lavrov, and they seem, from the accounts that we get from foreign news sources, we don't get such accounts from mainstream media in this country, they seem to be on the same page. They seem to be talking about serious matters in dispute between Russia and the United States, but in a productive fashion and without the fantasies of the Manchurian candidate run by the evil genius in the Kremlin. They seem to be doing business, for lack of a better term, in a way that looks pretty good at the G20. At the same time, the Russians have promoted a ceasefire in Syria in association with Turkey and Iran that stops the vicious civil war the Obama administration produced in Syria with its notion of overthrowing the Syrian government and the vast flow of refugees that resulted from that. So these are positive developments. These are worthwhile activities. And it seems to me that the outrage of the American liberal establishment, for lack of a better term, against what's being done here is in some sense justified because, in fact, the Trump administration is making progress. They're doing things that the neocon Democrat conjunction, the Obama and Clinton campaigns, didn't want done, and that's good.
And as Gareth Porter, who's a pretty preeminent journalist on Middle Eastern affairs for many years, had pointed out a day or two ago, whatever bellicose rhetoric about Iran that Trump has put forward, the institutional constraints on what he's going to be doing basically determine that not much is going to change from Obama's relatively sane policy of lifting sanctions and generally defusing all of that going on over there. So it's just astonishing. I haven't been watching Amy Goodman that much lately.
Democracy,
it's on. I usually look at the transcript to see if, look at the website and the transcripts to see. And she did have Glenn Greenwald on there yesterday saying some of his usual coherent thing. But the narrative, again, I watched it this morning just because I wanted to see if there was anything going on that might. It was mostly about, I don't know, about Flynn or whatever. But it's the attitude, and it's like, what is it that what journalistic ethics is it that basically you demonize someone, even if they're president? He's not Adolf Hitler. You just demonize him, and that everything that you say about him has to be framed in these jaundiced terms. I don't understand what has happened that it has come to this point, that you can't just step back and say, well, he's not a nice man. He's got a lot of not nice people around him. He wants to do some really bad things, especially in relationship to not dealing seriously with climate change, obviously. And as Noam Chomsky is saying, he wants to make it as bad as he can, as fast as he can. Okay, that's horrible, fine. But why do you have to put on an attitude? It would be professional and helpful to look at all of this and to sort of step back. And some guests kind of do that. I mean, Greenwald kind of does that in the midst of the comments he's making about Flynn and what these leaks were and all this stuff. But where is the left? Where is a place to stand on the left to look at Trump in relationship to the whole thing in some accurate and helpful way?
If we wanted a serious opposition to this administration, we would work on climate change. That's exactly right. That's where they are indeed most vulnerable, because their position is so nonsensical. And it also is by far the most important issue, perhaps, that this administration will deal with, unless they manage to get their war on and with the nuclear power, which was never out of the question. The fact of the matter is that it's climate change that's the serious issue, and that we should be organizing and demonstrating about across the country.
As well as health care, I would add, although climate change is more important than even health care.
Well,
obviously.
I mean, it's
not that they're related.
I'm going to say it's not a choice in the sense that, if we do one, we don't do the other.
Yeah.
It certainly is the case that the health care direction is important to demystify. And here, perhaps unlike climate change, I think the Trump administration has given itself some wiggle room, awful phrase, that may be like what they've done in regard to the Middle East. Trump has said, yes, get rid of Obamacare, and there's good reasons for saying that. He says, but we're going to replace it with something much better. Well, okay, people have been willing to see, to listen to that and hear what is much better that this administration is actually going to produce. And by all signs, the administration is in an internal froth on how they possibly can say something that's going to be much better. But perhaps they will. And indeed, that's something we should be pressing for. We should be telling our representatives that, yes, abolishing Obamacare, which is a gift, after all, to the insurance industries, is an excellent idea, but only once Medicare for All is in place, only once single-payer health care is established for all Americans. That's what we should be doing, not worrying about whether Trump's relationship with the women around him needs work.
Well, that would require people to just sort of step back a second, calm down, put on a straight face, put on a poker face, and go into their congressperson's office and say, of either party, and say, this is what we want. Just to not to go in with any prejudged ideas, just let them know what we want. And if enough people do that, that might make some difference. I mean, I'm not
exactly.
I'm not living in a fantasy world. We understand all the economic interests involved in maintaining the for-profit system that we have. But the problem is that people's hatred of Trump is letting them get in the way of seeing anything and doing anything.
I think it's
And the part of the problem still has to be said that it's obviously the Democratic Party. The fact that all this is being done within the general framework of Democratic Party politics. And I'm not saying that there's no chance that people can work within that framework if they're willing to be truthful, if they're willing to understand what got the Democratic Party into this mess and how it might get out of it. But that would mean bringing radical points of viewpoint forward within that framework.
And it's important, I think, to see there that demonization of Trump is not innocent. Yeah. Demonization of Trump comes from people who want to oppose a serious health care system, who want to oppose a serious climate action, who want to oppose the bringing all the troops home. These are the people who are saying, look, we've got to hate Trump. These are the things that they actually want. We should understand that and focus on those things, those three in particular, and stop worrying so much about
give them
Trump's
a chance.
The cut of his jib.
Let's put Bernie Sanders and Tulsi Gabbard and Keith Ellison and who all and our local people and all these people, let's at least give them a chance to say, do you really want to draw down the military in a serious way? Do you really want single-payer health care? Do you really want a Green New Deal? Sort of combined anti-climate change and jobs program? Do you really want all these things? And if people say yes, fine, take them at their word for it, but then draw out what the following actions should be given that they're, and of course that many of them will waffle on that, say, well, this is only what we need to know, or first we have to get the Republicans out of office,
yeah,
and the Democrats back into office. No, let them put it forward now. Let them put it forward to who's ever in power now, just for the sake of finding out what people think and who's on your side and who's not.
But the problem is that these people who are being proposed as alternatives have bad positions on these matters. Sanders and Elizabeth Warren support the wars. They also are not critics of Israel in the way that you and I were talking about a moment ago. Mm-hmm. These Democratic liberals, I mentioned Cory Booker at the beginning of the hour, these are all people who are in favor of the very things that we're speaking against on war, health care, climate change. And the idea that they are putting themselves forward as champions on these matters over against a vicious Trump is a lie. That's the technical term. It's a lie. And they are working desperately to demonize the president administration in order to cover over their lies on these matters. We would do much better to go after the issues themselves, bring all the troops home, single-payer health care, climate change action, not as a pious hope, but a direct interference with American industry.
Well, the effect of the Clinton wing of the Democratic Party, meaning the wealthy wing of the Democratic Party, the effect of their of their policies, as were articulated in the last campaign, was to alienate the portions of the white working class, mainly the white working class, that they needed to stay in power. So, if these people want to be in power, I don't know how they think they're going to get back into power without doing something. They think that Trump, since whatever Trump is doing isn't going to work out for them, and it might not, that they're going to come running back to the Democratic Party. And they're just kind of waiting. And how long will it take? 6 months, a year, 2 years? Will the Democrats be able to get the Congress back in 2018? Without just people as people going to whoever is in power now and say and telling them what it is that they how they feel the world is working and how they feel it should be working.
There's some very dark possibilities here too. Few Americans know that the president commands a private army, which is called the Joint Special Operations Command, and is drawn from the various services, as we say in this country. Who said that service is a funny name for killing people?
I thought you said that.
Well, I was quoting somebody.
Okay.
The Joint Special Operations Command is a 70,000, count them, 70,000 military operation that reports to the President's National Security Council and nobody else. This group is a collection of American death squads. We found out rather quietly some months ago that they are active in the Obama administration. They were active in 70% of the countries in the world. And their activities included rendition, we call it. It's kidnapping and sending people off to various places where they can be forcefully interrogated. Obama piously said that he had forbidden torture in the American military, and so the American military kidnaps people, bad guys of course, and brings them to other countries where they can be tortured for the information that they undoubtedly have and that we need. Rendition, torture, the Joint Special Operations Command is in that business as well, and murder. That's what they do literally around the world, 70% of the countries of the world. And the use of the Joint Special Operations Command expanded exponentially in the Obama administration without, of course, any constitutional warrant. If asked, the Obama administration said, oh yes, the authorization for the use of military force passed after 9/11, 2001, authorizes what this Joint Special Operations Command is doing around the world. The rest of the world knows that the U.S. is running death squads, particularly in Africa, by the way. There are American JSOC forces in all but two African countries. What's going on, as I say, is known by the victims, but it's not known by Americans. But I must admit there was a surprise for me this week on the Joint Special Operations Command. Did you know that they have a university? The Joint Special Operations Command has set up an educational institution. Now, when we find American universities dying for a variety of reasons around the country, Sorry, I have a microphone problem here, apparently. The matter is quite serious, but this Pentagon group, to call it a Pentagon group is not quite right because the Pentagon command structure is bypassed by JSOC, and they report, as I say, to the National Security Council. They have established a university, and the university has produced a video about the dystopian future of American and world cities. And what it is, it looks like a video game, because it says, look, a few years down the road, we're going to have major social unrest in cities around the world, and we have to have new ways of fighting that. They look very much like the sorts of things that my grandson does on the in the video games, but these people are serious. These people are serious, and they're spending your money to do it. And they are talking about how, in fact, we're going to carry out military operations in cities against domestic populations who have become incorrigible. Now, there are people in American government thinking about that, and they're thinking about that precisely because the American underclass is showing an unwanted independence, such as making Donald Trump president. This is serious. This could be very serious indeed down the road. I was shocked to see that the video was out there, and I was even more shocked to see that there was a Joint Special Operations Command university producing things like this. We're in for some hard times, David.
Yes. No argument there.
You've been watching News from Neptune for the seventh week of 2011. A mutinous edition presented by Carl Estabrook and David Green, produced and directed by Jason Liggett and Yosef Lash. Inshallah, we'll be back next week with a new edition of News from Neptune to remind you, in the words of Edward DeVere, what's past is prologue, what to come in yours and my discharge. In the meantime, confusion to our enemies and a good night to you.